I may not be the smartest guy in the room, but Jen was very gracious. I'm smart enough that when she asked me to do something, it would be really, really a wise thing to do to say yes, because, and I mean that in the most complimentary sense, because, for instance, the International Freight Conference, the last one, in 15, I went to not quite sure what to expect. And if you haven't had the chance to attend, you students and practitioners, anything you can do to finagle a way to go, I just commend it to you, because it was fantastic for me to broaden academic as well as practitioners in this whole urban freight space. So it was very, very, very well done, well organized, and tremendously staffed. So that's my plug for the program. I'm here tonight, I'll tell you, coming from a program I got to do this morning in Berkeley with a bunch of real estate folks, and it was on campus, it was at their football stadium, and I got to tell you, it was pretty nice up there really early this morning with a great view of the city and a great view of the football team working down below. As nice as that was, though, this is my first time onto the SC campus after having been bothered by friends who are SC graduates for so many years saying, there's no more beautiful campus in the country. Oh, you got to go, you got to go. So I'm going to take a quick picture of a couple of sites to prove to those friends that I've finally been to Mecca and I've finally been to the campus. So you all are very lucky to get to work and go to school and network here on the university campus. Okay, so I think I only have about 3 hours worth of material, and I'll do my best to condense that down to like 2.5 hours, okay? Does that work for people's schedules? No. While I have a lot of material planned, I would encourage you, if you have questions, just get my attention, and we can go in different directions. We can kind of flex, and I want to make this as worthwhile for all of us as possible, and a big piece of that is to be conversational with it. And a big piece of it is to try and fix the clicker that I have just, there it is. Okay, it's back into one piece. Before I begin though, and whether we have questions while I speak, for sure, if you can wait, we'll have lots of time for questions at the end. Fair enough? So before I begin, Jen already took the first question that sometimes I ask, how many of us are prime members? So that one's off. And you are all statistically right on point. Every time I do that, it's, you're an enlightened, innovative, early adopter sort of group, I can tell, because you are at least at the average and above in penetration. So the question I'll ask is, how many of you choose not to work any of your shopping or any of your personal business on using e-commerce? Anybody just say this is a fad, it's never going to go anywhere? All right, well, that statistically is also what I expect. So my last poll question before we get into the material is, how many of you have bought something using your mobile device online in the last week? Any of us? Of course, yeah, right? We all have. How many have used their mobile device in like the last day to buy something? Right on. And then lastly, how many of you like in the last 10 minutes have used your mobile device to buy something? Okay, you're going to wait until I get into my talk, and then you're probably... We all know about the explosion of mobile when it comes to e-commerce, and I'm pretty thick-skinned. If I see you on your phone or your tablet, I won't be offended in the least. It won't be that I don't think you're paying attention or you're not engaged with whatever it is I'm saying. I know it's because you're just stimulating the economy and you're doing more online shopping, and that's A-okay, all right? Okay, so tonight what I would like to cover is really, really high level, where do we sit with some e-commerce facts. I'll try to get through that pretty quickly. We'll move into talk about last mile, some innovative strategies being done here in the States as well as overseas. We'll talk about Amazon. We can't really have a conversation like this without some talk about our friends to the north. But I don't want it to be too Amazon-centric, because there is a lot of very exciting activity that is indirectly driven by Amazon, but not directly. We'll talk about Walmart. If we have time, we'll talk about online grocery and some transportation issues associated with that. And really, if we get to go fast, we can talk a little I want to make sure we'll try, if we can, to talk about cross-border and what the next generation of cross-border e-com explosion really looks like. So a couple of facts to get started in B to C, or business to consumer. Today, globally, we are about $2 trillion. It's really hard to measure this, so everybody measures it a little bit differently. So about $2 trillion globally. In the US, we're sitting at about $350 to $360 billion in B2C e-commerce in 15. Asia, of course, like in so many ways, they're way ahead of us in penetration, in adoption, and in spending, and speed of adoption. They're over $1 trillion today, well on their way to some $2 trillion on their own. Penetration here in the U.S., depending upon how you adjust it, you know, we're anywhere from 7 to 9% of total retail sales now B2C. And growing, the latest figures out for the second quarter of 2016 that were recently released, we're sitting right there at 15, 16 some odd percent on year-over-year growth, okay? I hope you can see this in the back. If you can't, feel free to come on up. No, if you can't see it, let me know, and I'll be glad to share a couple of these charts with you. There's Amazon and there's everybody else. So looking at 2015 total revenue, you can see almost $100 billion from our friends at Amazon. Walmart is number two in retailers of its kind, at a whopping $13, $14 billion in 15. So about five or six times where Walmart is where Amazon is today. I will call out, if you can't see it, these other big players, Dell and Apple, they're not traditional retailers. They're not like Walmart, or they're not like Office Depot or Nordstrom, but they are examples of tremendously successful online retailers selling their dedicated merchandise. So really, Apple is number two in terms of total revenue, but I like to discount Dell and Apple because they have different characteristics, okay? So that's total revenue. Then if you look at who is drawing the biggest percentage of U.S. sales, just in the U.S., lo and behold, Williams-Sonoma and Staples. Anybody surprised at that? Yeah, I was surprised first when that surfaced. Staples is in an industry that's just getting racked by the impact of e-commerce. That's the industry. But Staples has been smart with a lot of really, really impactful investments. And lo and behold, they're getting 50% of revenue from online. Williams-Sonoma, J. Crew, these are some others. Some of these names are companies that are getting really bad press because their traditional sales are struggling, and many of them are closing stores, right? So to the extent that Macy's can continue to be smart, and Kohl's and Penny's and Best Buy getting smart with drawing more and more revenue to their online experience, the better they'll be in competing with the people from Seattle. That makes sense? Oh, and this is in alphabetical order. No, excuse me, this is in percentage order, and if you can't see it here at the bottom, Target and Walmart. Remember, Walmart was $14 billion, but think about this, it's less than 3% of their total revenue in the US. Tremendous headroom, if you will, or runway potential to grow that number. Real quickly, here we are in the US. The middle bar is where we sit today, and as I said, depending upon how you slice it, we're almost at 10%. Our friends in China, not only bigger, but deeper penetration. And good heavens, look, in 2020, some projections see total penetration in China to be 20% of retail. Tremendously impactful. Okay, a couple of other tidbits. Online in the US is a very concentrated industry. Look at this. For retailers, $250 million and up, $250 million and up, control almost 90% of online revenue. That's a lot of power. That's a lot of leverage. That's a lot of loyalty. Does that make sense from a buyer's perspective? It's not at all a fragmented industry today. Okay, and then just a couple more facts, and then we'll move on from here. to look at growth rates. The black is total retail sales. No surprise, in the last few years, been in the mid to low single digits. The blue line is e-commerce sales in the US. After the recession, of course, where we saw some shrinkage, even online, continues on that trend of about 15 some odd percent. And then you have this goofy line that's Amazon at the red, which, while bumped pretty close to a 15% growth a year and a half ago, is now back up above the trend line for e-commerce sales. So the big is continuing to be growing faster. So I'm a real estate person by background. So I, in my current role, I deal with retailers and shippers and investors and real estate developers and people like that. And I'm often asked, well, how big a piece of our industry, our warehouse and distribution space, does e-commerce represent? We did a survey in 15 and concluded about almost 50% of large building leases, greater than 250,000 feet, almost half of that leasing nationwide went to either direct e-commerce retailers or 3PLs expressly focused on e-commerce. So in the real estate world, as in the supply chain world, these are really significant. Okay, so everything I've shown so far has talked about business to consumer. That's what gets most of the publicity. But what we overlook too often is the whole B2B world online, which is about twice the size of the universe, if you will, on business to consumer. In the US, we're gonna grow to nearly $1 trillion just on our own in B2B, with a very, very significant share of total B2B transactions likely to be done online. This is work done by Forrester Research. And by the way, our friends at Amazon, they have a very compelling offering in B2B. And Jeff Bezos is working really hard to get a bigger and bigger piece of business to business. And just by simple definition, I love this quote by a market analyst who talks about, you know, in business to consumer, you try stuff on, you look at it, the color, you make decisions. But hey, B2B, it's much more cut and dried. Commodities, things like that, where the sky's the limit. We'll talk more in a few moments about inventory. And is there a bigger thing in the supply chain and retail industry today than properly managing inventory? Where it is, how much of it, how quickly can we get it where it needs to be? And I love this ratio. A number of you look at this, the relationship between inventory balances and sales. Every single retailer is all about trying to get the biggest sales out of the smallest inventory investment, right? Walmart, in their latest earnings, Doug McMillon, who's the CEO, he was trumpeting, he was almost leading with improvement that they're making in bringing inventory balances down, operating the company and growing the company with less inventory in the channel. So this relationship, you can see in 2012, it was quite a different perspective. Ideally, right, the retailers want to see the relationship between inventory and sales to be as low and nimble as possible. We've talked a little bit about the Amazons and Walmarts and some data around that. If you're not Amazon, how do you compete with this? Okay, so let's talk about a couple of these. Every retailer who's trying to compete with the big two or the big three online, the way they're going to succeed is they're going to leverage what they have that the online guys don't. That's not rocket science. It is rocket science how they use those assets. So if you're Target or Walmart or Best Buy or anybody like that, you have something Jeff Bezos doesn't have. Walmart's got 4,500 different physical locations near every one of our homes. So just their strategy is very much like what Brian Cornell, who is the CEO at Target, he said, look, we're not going to beat Amazon.com with just our Target offering, Target.com. He said, no, we're going to beat Amazon with Target, well, .inc, if you will, with Target Corporation, using in-store, using ship from store, using pickup in store, click and collect, like throw everything they can at this problem and differentiate themselves from the pure online players. It's really, you leverage the assets you have. We'll talk some more about some of those strategies in a minute. We talk about omnichannel, right? Doesn't care, the successful retailer of the future is going to have a seamless experience between their online and their in-store. Doug McMillan, the head of Walmart, who just invested almost $3.5 billion in buying Jet.com. A lot of you saw this recently. It's fascinating. We can, if we run out of time tonight, we can talk about it afterwards. But Doug McMillan gets it. He says, look, we're going to succeed because the customer doesn't care how it is that we touch them, just as long as we touch them seamlessly, effortlessly. He says, yeah, for those customers, it's just Walmart, and we have to be able to serve the customer in all those different channels. You hear a lot of talk about omnichannel. To me, this is kind of the omnichannel, the moral of the story is being able to do that successfully. Okay, how many of you, how many of us have used click and collect or buy online and pick up in store? Anybody? Not surprising. Do you mind me ask, has anybody used that first with a Target store? Okay, yeah, I do that occasionally. Target's a great example of channeling a significant share of their online orders to get people in the store to pick up. You know, 30% of online orders touch a Target store. Home Depot is another all-star. Very, very significant drive getting us to a Home Depot store to pick up our online. How many of us, when we do that, we're making impulse purchases. We're buying extra things because we see it when we're in the store. It's a huge traffic generator and a revenue generator. Now, how many of us have been to a Sears store in the last year or two? Okay. Well, yeah, well, hold up your hand high. Don't be bashful. Great, thank you. Even Sears, the poor Sears that gets so maligned and written off by the market, even Sears does a good job of driving a very significant share of their online to their stores. Maybe it's enough to save Sears or to help them restructure. The jury's still out on Sears. You need to go more often, I think.
No. I went in the store, they didn't have what I wanted, and it takes me a month to have to go back to the store to get my product. I don't think that's very efficient.
It absolutely is not. And my anecdote is I went to Home Depot to buy a faucet to replace the one that was damaged, and I finally found a salesperson, and I said, where can I find this? And she looked at it and said, this is Home Depot, remember? Oh yeah, you can get that on Amazon. It's way cheaper than what we have. So I didn't report her to management. Okay, some of you have seen me talk about this subject, but it gets me really, really excited. You recognize a lot of these brand names? Probably Warby and Bonobos. You're a fashionably dressed group. Maybe you bought mattresses through Casper. You know, these are what commonly are called pure play retailers, former pure play retailers. I do a lot of work around the additive relationship between online, formerly pure online players, and existing real estate, traditional pop-up or very limited store physical presence. Does that make sense? So old thought used to be it's a zero-sum game. Sales that go online are lost sales from the store, and vice versa, that if physical store sales are going up, it must come from somewhere. You know, online sales go down. That's the complete wrong math. It truly is additive. It's symbiotic, if you will. All of these retailers have discovered, look, if I have even a handful of physical stores across the country, it makes my online sales in those markets go up. Best example of this is not a new, young, hip, emerging company. Great example is Macy's. I was with a Macy's merchandising exec, and he told this great story of In Minneapolis, they closed a mainline store, a full mall-like store. And he said, do you know what happened to the online sales that we track from Minneapolis? He said, we thought that they would go up because shoppers don't have the physical store to go to. He said, actually, they went down because people were shopping somewhere else. They couldn't go into the Macy's if they wanted to touch and feel and get waited on. So they shopped somewhere else, you know? So it is that relationship. We will see more and more people do this. One player that does this now that gets a lot of publicity is Amazon. So I'm from Seattle, the home of the first Amazon bookstore. Have any of you been to an Amazon bookstore, either that one or down here? Yeah. It is a fascinating concept to watch. And it's more my retail geekiness than supply chain, but I commend to you what you can read about the Amazon bookstore. It's a very, very curiously positive experience when you go in there. So Amazon used to be a pure play retailer, and now they're dipping their toe in physical. And not just the bookstores. Jeff is going to do 100-some-odd pop-ups in malls in these next 18 or 24 months. There are a couple in malls here in Southern California already. Little bitty pop-ups that sell their devices, but it's another way to touch the consumer and another way for the consumer to get excited about Amazon. Small retail pop-ups, this is a very, very cool emerging strategy. But think about this. So these are companies that, you know, Trunk Club, Warby, they have built their supply chain originally to be pure e-commerce. But now they have to stock two stores in, you know, one in Chelsea in Manhattan, and one in Chicago, and one in DC, and one in Santa Monica, and maybe one in San Francisco. So now they got to figure out, right, how to get inventory to stores, whereas it used to go to just one fulfillment center, or maybe two distribution centers. I talk a lot about how in the US, we think we're the center of the earth when it comes to like supply chain and logistics and a lot of those activities. Current academics in the room notwithstanding, we learn way more, right, from China, from Japan, from the UK, and from continental Europe. We've learned so much about remote delivery. Some of us were talking during the reception about there's so many brown boxes coming to apartment buildings in Manhattan or in LA or San Francisco, where the landlord says, we don't have the room for all these brown boxes. So you get 5 deliveries, or you get 8 deliveries a week, and then after that, you're on your own. We will refuse those deliveries to a condo building or an apartment. Okay, so we need to get better at what they're good at in other countries, and that is delivery to lockers, delivery to other remote locations. So how many of you have used Amazon lockers or anybody else's locker concept here or overseas? And would you use it again? Have you used it more than once? I got mostly yeses and one no. I use this occasionally. Look, I live in the suburbs. It's not a very high crime area, but I had something stolen off my front stoop. It's the kids who follow the UPS truck, hoping that something valuable and not like a pack of crayons gets delivered by Amazon. And so I have higher value things delivered to the locker at my neighborhood Safeway. It's right on the way. I'm there anyway, and I pick it up. It's painless. If you haven't tried the locker concept, I commend it to you. Just give it a go when you place your checkout, your shipping order. Take a look at that. I bet there's a locker location close to you. If there's not yet, there will be. You know, a year from now, there'll be many, many more. David Simon, who, you know, the number one high-end shopping mall owner and operator in the country, he's investing in a lot of companies, new technology to help consumers pick up their online purchases not from multiple stores in a shopping mall, but from one central location where 4 stores would send your order. It's ready for you when you come by and you pick it up at the curbside. I was telling Jen at the Urban Freight Conference last year, I learned about this fascinating technology that, again, our friends in Scandinavia are way ahead. So if you have a Volvo, if you're in the program, you can actually have deliveries to your trunk, even if you're not there. If you're at work or you're at school, you know, using your mobile device, you can unlock the car trunk when the delivery person is there because they've just sent you a message over the web. You pop the trunk, they put your order in there and close the trunk, and you go on your merry way. It's cool, isn't it? My new favorite, I think this came from Denmark. I call it direct to fridge. Anybody heard about this? Yeah, well, in the States, we haven't figured this one out. Again, you have a device that connects your mobile to a lock on your front door. This is really getting out there, right? You can unlock your front door when the delivery person who's delivering your groceries, maybe, is at your door. You open the door, the person goes in, puts the groceries in your refrigerator, and then you know when that person left from looking at your mobile device. It's either really, really convenient or really creepy to have that. But these are examples of some really cool technologies that are coming out of different parts of the country. And then lastly, in terms of emerging technologies, I keep this chart up to date. A lot of you recognize many of these, you know, Deliv, Instacart. These are probably some providers that you all have used to have your groceries delivered. Or if you shop at Brooks Brothers and Saks or Ralph Lauren, chances are ShopRunner has been the interface between you and the store, and they're arranging a delivery to your home. Deliv is a great example, I think, because UPS a few months ago invested in Deliv. They took an equity investment in this small emerging technology last mile delivery company, which is kind of a head scratcher at first. Who's better at last mile delivery than UPS? You'd think they can do this better than anyone. But I commend to you, we'll see more investment like this because these small companies have little kernels of technology that the big players don't have and that the big players need to be successful. And because I'm from Washington State, where marijuana is legal across the state, I really like this one. Any customers here of Nest Drop? Okay, well, you're a bashful audience, but in Colorado and in Washington, there are services that it's a little bit sketchy. I think it's a little bit illegal, but will deliver legal marijuana to your home. So how convenient is that? And I don't think they do it yet, but they really need to be in the fast food or the junk food business delivery. They get them multiple orders. Yeah. The last one I'll point out here, I'm sorry, curbside. Curbside is this technology that helps retailers do just what it sounds. When online orders come into a store, they facilitate picking, they facilitate the app when the customer drives into the parking lot, so sure enough, there's somebody who runs out and puts your order in their trunk. It's called curbside. Best Buy uses it. Target invested heavily in deploying curbside in hundreds of stores. And they thought it was going to be the next best thing. But they decided very abruptly to kill their curbside investment. And within 10 days of that announcement, CVS Drugs said, "We are putting curbside in every single store in America." To me, it's just fascinating. Think about that. Two companies that have some similarities in how they have to touch the customer, some similarities in how their supply chain feeds stores, and they've taken completely polar opposite approaches to that potential last delivery method. That makes sense? Okay, a really good question earlier tonight during the reception, I was asked about FedEx and UPS and Amazon Logistics. In the media, just in the last week, it's like all of a sudden the media figured out that Amazon might be getting into the package delivery business for other people. Well, some of us have been saying that's exactly what Jeff Bezos is doing. And I can tell you this from having worked there, and now I can legally confirm, that's been the master plan all along. It's to build a compelling alternative to UPS and to FedEx, and to some degree DHL. So the business is growing, they're investing heavily in this network, and it's pointed expressly at competing with those other big package carriers. If I'm back here in 2 years, I dinner is on me for everybody if, well, 3 years, that Amazon will be delivering brown boxes for other customers, not just for Amazon orders. Okay. Very disruptive to UPS and to FedEx. Reverse logistics, returns. I call it the gift that keeps on giving. Took a little informal poll before the program of how many of us buy a lot of stuff online and then return it. Well, we all do, if we're honest. The National Retail Foundation came up with this ratio. About 10% of in-store purchases get returned, but a whopping 30% of online purchases get returned. So think about the disruption where supply chain and getting inventory to a distribution center, and then from a distribution center to my house, and then I turn right around and I return 60, 70 some odd percent of those orders. It's become a huge industry, right? It's been a big disruptor to the real estate industry because that takes a certain kind of building that's different than just a storage and fulfillment building. And many of you are very familiar with, there are a lot of companies that have grown up focused exclusively on this return management. If you return purchases to the store, statistically, there's a significant share of us that buy stuff after we do a return. Again, we're in the store and we make impulse purchases. Okay, while we're talking about shipping, I'm often asked, how is it that Amazon can make any money giving away free delivery? Well, the fact of the matter is, they don't make any money giving away free delivery, number one. The other fallacy is there's no such thing as free delivery. Either we're paying for it as the customer, or the stockholders are paying for it because it's just an expense to the company. Does that make sense? It is the secrets, one of the secret sauces of Amazon, that they can deliver our purchases as fast as they do, that their supply chain is so sophisticated and so high speed as to do that. Everybody else has got to compete and try and deliver a compelling delivery offering. So this is what I call my wall of fame. So this is the first column is 2 years ago, the average days of delivery for direct-to-consumer orders. And then this column is just this year. JCPenney and Best Buy are my all-stars who by creativity, by investment, and adoption of improved technology, have improved their delivery time significantly. How many of us would be willing, are satisfied with maybe a 6 or 7 day delivery period? For some items, that's probably okay, right? Amazon has got us addicted to this instant gratification where we click, and then we want it right away because he offered to deliver it to us right away. So I submit to you, everybody can't do that. And long term, Amazon probably can't afford to do that themselves, just giving away very, very expensive last mile delivery. So you're starting to see some incentives. Some online retailers, if you've gone to, you know, to check out, they'll say, I will deliver your order in 2 days for either nothing or some small fee. But if you wait 5 days, if you opt for slower delivery, we'll give you a little incentive. You know, we'll give you 3 free music downloads on our lame music platform. Things that aren't really valuable, but it's a perceived value. We're going to see more incentives to all of us to be patient. And if we really, really, really don't have to have that pair of socks tomorrow, if 5 days from now is okay, it sure helps the delivery networks and sure helps those retailers deliver in a cost-effective way. Okay, let me talk briefly, because it's such a hot issue in so many manifestations of our business, green impacts, okay? And it's really hard to be green in this industry, right? There are academics and professionals here who probably spend a lot of their time studying how to improve the carbon footprint, as well as kind of the ecological footprint of supply chain, transportation, and packaging. So I mentioned David Simon of Simon Property Group, the big shopping malls. He hired Deloitte to do a study which evaluated, is it more eco-friendly to shop in a shopping mall or to shop online? And big surprise, that study came back and said basically it's greener to shop in a shopping mall. Okay, not a big surprise since he hired them to say that. But if you look at the fine print, it really comes down to some basic propositions. If you and five friends get in the car and drive to the shopping mall, you're in one car, and you shop at 10 different stores, and you come home with purchases from all these different stores, you get back in that same car, and you all go home, that's a pretty green operation. The retailer has gotten goods there in bulk, in 53-foot trailers, and you've taken it away in bulk. But how many of us shop that way in shopping malls? Not very likely. The other you know, key bet and proposition is if we're ordering an individual package of toilet paper or an individual pair of socks online, and it comes in a box that those retailers try really hard to make the box properly sized, the chances are they're shipping us a lot of air at the same time. Not very ecologically responsible. So let's all take a pledge. The next time we buy online, you know, shop one time a week. Does this sound familiar? It's like old school going to the grocery store. Make a list, go online from one retailer and order everything you can so it comes in one box instead of, you know, 12 ill-fitting boxes. And then lastly, the difference between speed and eco-footprint. A truck delivering one box to my house versus a truck delivering 10 boxes to a locker that we're picking up from because we're going to the grocery store anyway, significant impact in terms of the ecological ramifications. All right, employment. The one thing I want you to take away is very, very large fulfillment centers, Amazon, Walmart, Target, Wayfair, retailers like that. They have tremendous employee density. You know, 1,000 people in one of these buildings most of the year, sometimes going to 2.5 times that at peak. These are big employers that have a lot of single occupancy vehicles driving to them and driving away. Not very green, but really disruptive if you live in a town that has one of these during a shift change. Okay, so I confessed, one of my passions is logistics real estate. That's what I did at Amazon working in the supply chain world. I break down what kind of buildings and what kind of assets are we going to have going forward into four basic categories, two dimensions. Urbanization impact, increased urbanization drives a different kind of building, and service level, how fast, how compressed a delivery time. So let me take a moment, walk you through this, and then we'll take the turn and we'll finish our last 10 minutes in a blaze of glory. The very, very large buildings, the large fulfillment centers out in the Inland Empire, in Moreno Valley, in Paris. Million square feet, a lot of people, a lot of boxes, and a lot of trips. This is where inventory is kept. The whole world, right, in online fulfillment is trying to get inventory as close to the consumer as possible. So the next category that I identify is smaller fulfillment centers that are closer in. You know, they're in Chino, or they're in San Jose. They're in suburban, but close in suburban New Jersey. These maybe are 400,000 and 500,000 square feet of building. And then cross docks. This is what UPS does. This is what Amazon Logistics does. These are hubs, right? They're pallets in and pallets out on their way for final delivery. These are popping up in 2 and 300,000 square foot sizes. And then lastly, the last mile depots. And I will submit to you again, when we come back in a couple of years, if I haven't overstayed my welcome tonight, we'll be talking even more about these last mile depots. These are 30, 40, 75,000 square foot buildings that are in Midtown Manhattan, and they're on south of Market in San Francisco, and they're in Brooklyn and close in Chicago. Box trucks in, little bit of inventory, very high velocity inventory kept in those buildings, and then delivery on bikes or hand carts or private vehicles. So these are really the four big main categories of real estate. And in your market here, I can point to examples of each one of those. The very first Amazon last mile depot, this type of building, we did in Inglewood, not too far from the airport. Okay, so grab me, we can talk more if that's not making any sense. Last mile depot, I'm not going to dwell on this. It's all about, do you have the right inventory in the right places? Is your inventory allocation model sophisticated enough? I guess, are there enough USC graduates doing this math as to do it correctly or not? Online grocery, how many of us bought online groceries in the last, 2 months? Anybody? Okay, you will. I will. Chances are we all will. Today it's not a very significant share, but it's growing faster on the e-commerce end than any other category just about on the web. Tremendous ramifications and challenges for supply chain. Bananas are the single most sold item at Walmart. I was in Bentonville yesterday and I couldn't believe when they told me that. You go into a Walmart, whether it's a big one or a little one, the bananas are right there by the front door in most buildings. You know how hard it is to manage the supply chain, the delivery, the handling, the pick and pack and preparation of a banana? It's Walmart doesn't make any money selling their bananas, that's for sure, because they're so labor intensive and they're so difficult to get right. I'm almost this category. In another couple weeks, I will cross over from blue into, and I'm from gray to red, and I've resigned myself to it. This didn't really come through, but this is about 25%. Almost 25%. It's not just you millennials in the room, it's people that look like me. But the distinction is I'm buying different things than you millennials are. My generation is buying milk and big things of detergent and dog food and stuff that I guess I'm too frail to bring to the car and bring to the house. Whereas you millennials, you're buying heavily online groceries with, very, very nice high-end prepared meals and all kinds of fancy food stuffs that you're too busy playing and working to get by Whole Foods or the equivalent to shop. So we come at it from different directions. Growing, 15, 16%, easily that much here over the next few years, growing to some $25 billion. However, it's gonna be disruptive, but today it's not even 4% of total grocery. Again, so you supply chain experts, you have a little bit more time to figure out how to handle the bananas and the dishwasher detergent and the dog food properly through your chains, because that number is gonna change significantly. And lastly on grocery here is what we buy the most of are the big heavy things, dog food and non-food other items. Okay. Talk briefly about Walmart. Walmart has bounced. After 9 quarters of decreasing revenue or decreasing rates of increase in their online revenue, they finally hit a bounce. I call it the, if you're a baseball fan, Yogi Berra said, it ain't over till it's over. After a lot of bad press and bad market reaction to Walmart, while they are investing billions of dollars in their online and billions of dollars in their supply chain and in their inventory management. Lo and behold, store traffic's up, profits were up, their online sales are up, and they turned around and invested in Jet.com. Anybody shop Jet.com? You'll hear more about this technology. The reason Doug McMillon bought this online operator of Amazon alumni called Jet is because they have a proprietary technology that I commend to you to learn more about, a proprietary technology where in a dynamic way, when you're adding to your cart, when you're ordering online, the algorithm knows the best direct shipper to arrange to have send that item to you. They have some inventory in their own Jet.com fulfillment supply chain, but I'm describing it in just very, very simple terms. It's a very cool technology. Is it worth $3.5 billion alone? Remains to be seen, but it was a key bet that Amazon has made, and that acquisition just closed a couple of weeks ago.
So is that like a virtual warehouse?
Yes, it's a combination of fulfillment from three big Jet.com buildings doing direct fulfillment, but most of it is dropship or direct fulfillment from the manufacturers. Online grocery for Walmart, dedicated FCs for their online, a shipping offering, online marketplace. That's when other retailers appear on their online real estate, right? JD.com, you know this from China, and Tmall. We'll talk about marketplace internationally if we have a minute. And then they're paying their people more. So might be a winning combination. So don't count Walmart out. Amazon, on the other hand, they only got 310 million active shoppers. Jeff really knows 50 to 60 million Prime members like us, and a significant increase in how close they are to the consumer and getting closer to us all every day. Oh, I'll skip over this, take my word for it. They're continuing to grow at a rapid rate. The power of Prime. Now more than half of their total gross merchandise value comes from Prime customers. Prime customers are really, really loyal, and Prime customers spend a lot of money on the platform, much more so than non-Prime customers. All right, just a couple of scary things. I didn't share this with Walmart yesterday because I didn't think there was value in it, but 42% of peak online sales went to our friends at Amazon. If you add up the next 10, they don't quite get to 25%. How scary is that if you're any one of those retailers? Lo and behold, Walmart gained 14 million additional visits last peak. That's awesome, 14 million. But they still lost share to Amazon. They went from a 7% share of traffic to a 6% share. That's pretty discouraging. Okay, now fashion. In my waning moments, if you're not buying clothes yet on Amazon, chances are that's another thing that we'll be doing differently in a couple years. Very, very close to being the biggest fashion retailer. Not the biggest online fashion retailer, but very close to being the biggest fashion retailer in the U.S. We've come a long way from buying books to buying fashion, even high-end designer fashion. And private label. Every grocery store has got a private label line, right? So does Amazon. These items are just the tip of the iceberg of what they're doing by private label. Grab me afterwards. We can talk about sort of the bargain with the devil, if you will, where retailers want to work with Amazon because it's great visibility. But every time a retailer makes a sale on Amazon.com, there's a little bit of data that goes to Amazon about how to better compete with their retailer customers. You see that circle? That's what's led them to develop really, really compelling private label. Okay, for you supply chain geeks, this is a bit of a complicated chart, but you get the idea. Amazon now is in the licensed maritime business. You know about their air service. The real beauty of what they do is here at the bottom. Again, we can talk about this in more detail afterwards, but because of their sort center network, their hubs that I talked about, they're able to squeeze a whole lot of cost out of delivery that the other players aren't able to do. So they do so much sorting themselves in their own network that by the time they're ready to either go to a last mile depot and put it on trucks to homes, buildings, or lockers. I think a lot of you were aware, a couple of years ago, Amazon struck a remarkable arrangement with the United States Postal Service to do direct postal injection. You know what that is? It's taking a pallet directly to one neighborhood post office, one zip code. It's already pre-sorted. There's nothing the Postal Service has to do except take the shrink wrap off the pallet and put it onto five delivery trucks. All that sortation work was done by Amazon. Consequently, that last mile for the Postal Service for Amazon is really, really inexpensive. USPS delivers more brown boxes, more last mile e-com purchases than any of the other providers. Do you get that? The Postal Service does more last mile delivery than UPS or FedEx do. Well, I like to call it Benjamin Franklin, who created the US Postal Service 240 years ago. He's like the greatest last mile strategist, because today we're using that as last mile delivery more than the other services. May not be enough to keep USPS from going bankrupt, if you can ever be a quasi-government agency and go bankrupt, but it's putting a tremendous amount of volume and revenue through the post office. Oh, we've beaten this one to death. We know Amazon is powerful, and they're trying really hard to get to be more and more powerful. So let me close with just, what do you do if you're not Amazon? And then we'll talk briefly about cross-border, and then I'll open it up to questions. So we've talked about how unusual Amazon is. We've talked about how unusual Walmart, you know, kind of is. If you set Amazon and Walmart aside, and maybe even Target aside, the rest of the retail world really has no choice. If they don't have the scale, if they don't have the competency, if they don't have what I call the courage to do self-performed fulfillment for online customers, they have to pay somebody. So as an industry, I'm tremendously bullish on the third-party logistics industry. Retailers out there who are trying to compete online, they have to pay somebody to do this for them. I expect there's going to be a tremendous surge in growth of the 3PL industry. Trucking is going to be very different. The demand continues to grow. But 3PLs that can do not only transportation, but can do fulfillment within a fulfillment center, they're going to hire like crazy. And this is very, very exciting work. So retailers have no choice if you're not Amazon or some of the big players. And I also commend that they really don't have much time. Amazon continues to build scale. They grow share faster than the market. It's really hard when Walmart grows at 11%, they're online. That's awesome. That's worthy of celebration on their analyst phone calls. But by the way, Amazon was growing faster. So they're losing sight of the market leader. Investment in new venture investment in emerging technologies around supply chain, some of these new technology companies around how to maximize less than a truckload in a more economic way. The Coupang in Korea, the JD.com in China. Tremendous investment. Here is this four, five, six, round numbers. In 2015, there was about $15 billion of VC investment from private investors in that space. But lo and behold, what's happened in the last couple of quarters, that's really slowed down. Maybe the market is getting more mature. Maybe the investors are starting to realize, you know, let's wait. We're going to fund more mature companies. We're not going to do as much money in a round A. We're going to wait until propositions are better proven out. So what we see in 2016 so far is indicative of that. I think a maturity and a greater discipline There's still tremendous growth and great opportunity, but it won't be quite as reckless. The same trend, these are for corporate investors. These are the Googles of the world and people like that. Same conclusion, a slowdown in 16. Okay, my one bullet for cross-border, if we talk about one thing that you take away tonight, is the explosion of what cross-border is going to be like in the next 4 or 5 years. Today, a very small percentage of what we sell here in the States to China, to Europe, to other regions of the world is infinitesimal to what it's going to be 5 and 10 years from now. The inverse is also the same. We're going to see Jack Ma and his JD.com, a global marketplace, where we're all going to be buying more goods from overseas. That means a heavy, heavy dependence on new maritime channels, new ways of handling supply chain and delivery by air, probably a heck of a lot more growth around airports. This is going to be a game changer for what my clients are facing across the country, and significantly the kinds of employers and clients that you all in the room are going to be focused on. So keep your ears peeled if you haven't already. This is going to blow up in the years ahead. Okay, with that, I will bring my comments to a close. Thanks for hanging with me. We've got time for questions. The ramifications for automated delivery, whether it's autonomous vehicles on the ground or drones up in the air. Talk about drones, because it's a very, very intriguing proposition. The world, according to me, is if we were anywhere but in the US, we'd be way further along, right? You see this in Europe, in Asia, even Australia is much better at supporting this technology rather than limiting it, constricting it. So, number two, I don't have any doubt that we'll see implementation of drones for delivery in some form in the next few years, but my opinion, it's not going to be dropping on your front lawn or the top of your apartment building. I think, challenge me on this, but my take is we're going to see an application more of almost wholesale delivery. It'd be a payload that delivers a collection of orders that leaves Moreno Valley and it flies into the high desert someplace and lands and delivers at a community, think of a glorified locker, if you will, where it saves a truck from going all the way out there and all the way back. So I think some form of that kind of combined delivery we'll see first. But many know at Virginia Tech, they delivered a Chipotle burrito by drone. And this was big news. You see this? It's like fantastic. Those engineers at Virginia Tech now got one Chipotle burrito delivered.
Is that during the e-commerce?
Singapore, Food Panda delivers increasingly by drone. So that's my take on drones. Autonomous vehicles, I had the very good fortune of meeting with Alan Mulally, who used to be the CEO at Ford, and I put that question to him about autonomous vehicles. This was right after the tragic accident with the Tesla vehicle. And Alan, who's way smarter than I am, he said, absolutely, we're going to see autonomous vehicles. It's going to be a long time coming, he said. Now, I if I may put it back to you, those of you who think we may see autonomous vehicle implementation, how many of you think it's going to first really come to scale for line haul, for large vehicles, and how many of us think it's most likely to be last mile in some form? So line haul, is that going to be the leading edge of this? Cool. And those of you who have an alternative opinion that you think last mile is going to be more the leading edge of this? All right, I'm going to put both hands up because I am so conflicted. And you all are much better at the technical implementation side of this. It's fascinating to think about. Last mile is so complicated and there's just so many variables, especially in an urban environment. But is that any easier to solve and to protect us from than 80,000 pounds barreling down the freeway, whether it's a dedicated lane or not? with no driver at the wheel or no engaged driver at the wheel?
First, that's going to be there.
It'll be fun to find out. Good question. Thank you. Tom?
Ben, yeah, I'm starting to hear supply chain people talk about anticipatory logistics.
Oh, yes.
Right? So the idea that supply chains move in response not to actual sales, but you know what you put in your wish list on Amazon and your traditional rate of conversion to into actual purchases.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that a reality now? Are you seeing that happen, or is it?
The question is about anticipatory fulfillment. Amazon got a lot of headlines when some media hack said there are trucks driving around your neighborhood with stuff that you haven't ordered yet in anticipation of you ordering it.
It's the ice cream man.
Yeah. Creepy or convenient, right? So a two-part answer. The first is, if you haven't seen it, I commend to you, go online and Google, I think it's called Delivery Yesterday. It's a really clever cartoon concept on, I ordered something today, but it came yesterday. It's kind of around this anticipatory. It's kind of funny as academics and practitioners take it in the spirit that it's meant. It is a caricature. However, all that said, the serious answer is, I think it's inevitable that Amazon, for instance, this is a new application for the tremendous amount of data that they have on all of us. They know what we order and what we order it with and what time of day, week, month, and year we order it. I joke, sometimes they probably know what we're wearing when we order it, so I commend you also to cover up the camera when you go online just to make sure. But what better way to shorten the delivery, the satisfaction cycle, than for the math to prove out that Tom orders this kind of pajamas when he orders this kind of socks? And position that inventory close by in anticipation of your order. What do you think?
I can see for certain things that are easy to predict, you know, the next Harry Potter book, right?
Yeah.
Something like that, but it doesn't surprise me that if you use your wish list and you have a track record of converting those into sales, that it makes sense to take a risk on moving your supply chain.
Sure. Sure.
Also, they have the information that's related to all the pop-up ads that you
yes,
have.
Yes.
So, you were looking for a skirt, weren't you?
Yes. Yeah. 2 weeks ago, I was looking for it, and I'm not looking for it anymore.
So they have all that data, too.
It is so powerful and so scary. Yeah,
so Francis. What do you think about the cost of capital? We've been in this unusual scenario lately with an amazingly readily available capital flow. So what happens to us when the world goes back from being stuck of the Federal Reserve and capital gets smaller?
Yeah, the question is about we're in this long extended honeymoon with virtually zero interest rates and capital is so cheap. It's easier to be reckless and innovative when capital is so relatively cheap. What happens when we go back to a more normalized state? Number one, we've said for many years, right, haven't we? Well, next year rates are going to go up and this is going to be a different market. Eventually it will happen. So I would submit to you that there will continue to be a premium placed on developing most of these new technologies. And that the potential growth and the potential return on those investments is going to be continue to be so high that I think we'll see a lot of activity. It won't have a significant impact in the development of these kinds of technologies. It'll have a significant effect on those of us who want to buy homes and things like that. But I think these are different. That's my take. Inventory carry put even more pressure on keeping much more in Shanghai and much less on the floor of a Macy's in you know, Chicago. That's a good distinction to make. That will become a more and more expensive mistake to make.
Which is a huge part of all of that.
Huge part. This all is around, right, keeping the right inventory as close to the customer, but not too much and not too early and not too late. And be able to have the right selection, not just volumes, but have the right selection as close to the customer that you can deliver as fast enough to satisfy the customer.
Without discounting.
Without what?
Without having to discount it.
Yes, without having to discount it. Make a mistake, and you got a whole lot of winter coats come May because you messed up your inventory management. Yeah, the question is, some of these companies that radically improved their delivery, just throw money at it or redo the supply chain? Penny's, let me go back to that. Those of you who are familiar with the transformation at JCPenney in the recent years, right, they brought in a tremendously visionary retail merchandiser from Apple and a brilliant guy who did a wonderful job with the Apple stores, and he failed completely at Penny's. Completely different model. Smart guy, but he didn't quite fit into what Penny's needed. So the new leadership, many of whom significantly came from Home Depot, the CEO, I believe the head of supply chain, and maybe even the head of stores came from Home Depot, which are a hero story in how they have re-engineered their supply chain. They're using lessons that were learned and perfected at Home Depot and Target and deploying them at Penny's. So I would submit that's why Penny's they have seen an improvement in margin and an improvement in their supply chain performance because of taking lessons from where all those people used to work. It's whether it's going to be enough remains to be seen. That company has more challenges. Oh, Penny's, think of this, a great supply chain challenge. They're in the midst of rolling out white goods, appliances. You've seen this? For decades, Penny's didn't sell appliances. And the new administration said, you know, we should sell appliances because we can merchandise those really, really well. Talk about it, having to re-engineer your supply chain, running Docker khakis through your supply chain in poly bags is very different than moving refrigerators and washers and dryers. That's a company that's really, I think, worth watching carefully. The question is, how much is the consumer feeling about the return experience factor in?
Their innovation in that into the transaction.
Yeah, okay.
Makes something like this not happen again.
Internet Retailer Magazine, which if you don't subscribe to their newsletter, that's another one that I would commend to you. Heavy supply chain innovation that's going on with so many of these e-commerce players, as well as merchandising and front-end experience. So Internet Retailer is a great resource, and it's free, which is a plus too. They did a study, and I think the Retail Federation, National Retail Foundation partnered. How significant is the return policy to a buying decision? And it was way up there. It was neck and neck, a little bit ahead, I think, of free shipping. It was, do I have the confidence that I understand their return policy and I agree with their return policy? So that's a very significant part of the buying psyche. You have had that experience and you've told 40 people tonight. I'm guessing you probably have told other people of how awful this experience was. Yeah, a couple. It's the spiral of PR death, I call it. Contrast that. Casper is an example of one of these former pure play online mattress players, and there are a couple of others in that space. Has anybody bought a mattress online? Yeah, and it came in a box that is about this big, if it's a foam technology, you know, that big?
No, it's a huge.
Oh, a different brand perhaps. Casper's technology, it just when I hear your sad tale of woe, I think of compare and contrast that to 2 days later, there's a box on your front stoop, and you open up the box, and it self-forms. But you know, if you don't like it, they give you a 100-day guarantee. There's no way of getting it back in that box, but they'll come. It's such the total opposite. But it's directed at people like you and me who have had horrific experiences for an expensive item that we don't buy every day. We buy every 10 years, but still, it's disruptive and painful. So I hope you enjoy your mattress.
What kind of changes do you see this transformation doing in that little piece of the supply chain that goes through the port?
It's probably only as impactful as like the most important thing ever, the most disruptive, that what happens on our front steps and all the way back to the channel, right? And probably most significantly, last mile and what happens in the port, I would say, are the most disruptive. everything from slow steaming and maintaining more inventory in the Pacific to what really is going to be the ramifications of the enlarged Panama Canal. What really are the ramifications of raising the Bayonne Bridge in New York to allow taller ships in? What really will be the benefit and the payoff of deepening the dredging in Charleston and Savannah and places like that? So I don't mean to be evasive. I'm smart enough to know it's going to be hugely disruptive. I think there's this tremendous opportunity for really, really smart, very well-trained, experienced technicians to come alongside port operators and solve some of those issues. So I don't mean to be evasive, but it's a great way to end that opportunity is huge. Okay, well, thanks y'all for being very patient, and thanks for the good questions.